since IIT is known for producing, you know, the best of the technologists in the country, I would say, among other things, I'm very happy to be talking about the subject which is very closely associated to me, which is design and technology. I'm a design technologist. I try to use technology as one of the tools to design spaces and use research to intersect art, technology. Now, I'm primarily going to be talking about the T and the D of TED as technology, entertainment and design come together to form TED, and hopefully make this talk a little bit of entertaining as well for all you guys, and have some ideas worth spreading. Now, I also happen to do a lot of photography, so I like to use photographs that speak for themselves, and I'm going to be talking about a narrative of my life back and forth to give you some instances and what they actually taught me, which has actually become a very core principle of my life. So starting from here, I mean, this is me, my family. I was born to a very hardworking and intelligent father and a very creative and independent mother with an analytical mind. So I'm kind of gifted with good genes to use these kind of things in my work as well today. And going forward, I mean, something I really want to talk about, I think the average age of people in this auditorium, I think probably is 21 or 22. And something I want to talk about, jump on 22 years. 2009, I was 22 years old, and I happened to take my first flight from Delhi to Ahmedabad. It may not be a very big thing for a lot of people. But at that time, I think there was a very small little point of realization. Might be very naive for a 22-year-old to think like that, but it was actually for a conference I was attending in Ahmedabad. And what I realized is that you can actually travel for work. You know, you can create opportunities of work which allow you to travel. And that kind of became my agenda. And what I want you to do is kind of read out the names of the places which happened in the 5 years from 2012 to 2017. And we have London, Los Angeles, New York, San Francisco, Tokyo, Taipei, Milan, Brescia, you know, various places in Netherlands, France, Amsterdam, Dubai, Riyadh, and the list was kind of long. I'm not a travel enthusiast. I may not have covered a lot of countries as such. But all of these actually work-oriented. I created conscious opportunities of work that allowed me to travel. And I don't have the exact count, but possibly I took 200 plus flights in all of these 5 years, which I found it as a very tiny bit of achievement. But what happened in those 5 years is after that, I came back to India. And that is not because I watched the movie Sudesh. I was not inspired by that. But why I came back to India, the reason lies in the five lessons that I learned in these 5 years, which actually changed my life, was more of a revelation in some way or the other. I want to share my success story with you. And when I say success, I don't mean professional success, happiness and gratification. And which is the first lesson I want to share with you, that happiness and gratification is the best form of success. I'm very happy and feel fulfilled right now with what I'm doing right now in life. And I get this fulfillment, happiness, with everyday struggles that I do to push the boundaries and the limits of the work that I'm doing. So everyday struggle has actually become my happiness, and which is what I've been trying to do. And I run a small organization called Rat Lab, which I co-founded with my friend and partner, Pradeep. This was in 2012 in London, in the back of Architectural Association London, where I happened to pursue my master's in emerging technologies. But what came across as a small little idea and a passion of two people coming in together to create an organization has actually became the passion. And that kind of reflects in the kind of work that we're doing as well. And we're pretty much working on various scales of projects, doing installations, furniture, product. Being an architect, I'm doing architectural stuff, interior design. And all of that is coming together now into actual work. And I mean, sure, it does give me a lot of happiness with the output as well. And that's just a snippet of works that we're doing, right? From wall claddings to offices to spaces, to restaurants, facades. There are more of it. So all of these snippets, and I'm sure the work kind of speaks for itself as well, how we are trying to use technology to design something which is different, which the output is different, the results are very much different because we are using technology consciously, even to the large scale project. This is a shopping complex in Tokyo, which you were a part of, which is ongoing right now. And yeah, it scales down to various artworks. We have exhibition spaces, restaurant spaces. Yeah, I mean, there are installations. This was in Los Angeles. That's a restaurant in Saudi Arabia. This was in Mumbai, recently launched. This is again the same restaurant from inside. And I'm sure you can figure out with the language of it, the design language of it, how technology has actually played a big role to create these kind of forms and designs. And I surely seem happy looking sitting in front of the work as well. Now, but where the actual happiness lie is actually here, which is the back end, where we actually, you know, work towards creating something. So that is where the innovation lie. And that is exactly what gives me happiness and fulfillment. And that goes on to talking about the second lesson, which I really learned through time, that rebelling change is not the solution. Which is very contrary to what we usually believe in. If we don't like something, we try to rebel. We try to change something if we don't like. We try to change the system. We try to break the boundaries. And again, another very important thing that happened when I was again 22, became a very important number in my life, is a small little note. Even if you look at the glimpse through it, you'll understand what I was trying to do. This is written by a frustrated student of architecture, fourth year, not happy with how the things are. People are not able to understand what I'm trying to think. And that was frustrating. And what I realized was, I need to change this. I need to change the world's perspective towards me before they change mine. And that kind of, I took it as a challenge. But at the same time, when I worked towards that, I realized slowly that rebelling is not the solution. The only way to prove something wrong or prove your point right is to create a parallel system which, and build that up and make that talk for itself. And there are two important things that which can happen at that time. Either you will prove the other system wrong and prove yourself right, which is a good thing, but even better when you fail. And if you fail and you realize that the system was actually right, you learn a lot through that process, and which is what I tried to focus on as well. And that comes down to what we're trying to do now as well. I run an educational school, which is called RatLab Education, where we teach students and professionals about design technologies. So that's the core subject which we teach, and that kind of happens, runs across in various cities, it's happened in various countries, and we've been expanding to do to cater to more than 1,000 people in the last couple of years, and we're about to touch you know, about 50 workshops that we've been doing. And now we have 3-day modules to a full semester program. Now this entire school is independent. We do not have a physical space, so to say. It runs on an idea and how we work with the students. There's a very interesting image that I came across on the internet the other day, which talks about these big companies who are actually purely based on an idea and what they can do with this idea, what, how they can use information. Uber, for example, one of the biggest cab companies, does not own any cabs. Facebook, one of the biggest media content generator right now, does not produce its own content. I think all of us have been generous enough to Mark Zuckerberg to produce that for them. And that is exactly what has been happening. There is a very interesting aspect of ownership and liabilities. And this pretty much became our agenda for RatLab Education as well, that we don't have to have a physical school in one space. We're restricting ourselves. It's based on an idea. It's based on a thought which can run anywhere in the country and cater to any kind of students and professionals. And I think so far we've been successful enough to do that and trying to scale it up as well. The third thing I want to talk about, which is quite interesting, is about the speed and patience. Now that is a very important thing that I realized. And there's a very interesting quote by Bill Gates that most people overestimate what they can do in 1 year and they underestimate what they can do in 10 years. I think it's a very common mistake that we do. We try to speed up things which is beyond the patience levels that we can have. And the whole matter of speed and patience need to strike a balance. I'm talking about speed at a macro level, which is a localized thing, and patients at a speed at a micro level and patients at a macro level, which is a global thing. So you have to make a balance between both and try to control that. And we've done that through, and you have to build a foundation. That is very important when you talk about speed. What is the right speed? How do you build a foundation? In my school days, when I was a kid, this is pretty much how I spent my school days, with computers, with motherboards, chipsets, opening up any kind of electronics that I could find. I used to be quite a notorious kid, try to kind of challenge things, try to break things, and just to try to understand what they do. And this actually I realized now, I mean, I was hacking in ethical ways. I was creating viruses to crash people's computers, not so ethical ways. I won't recommend you do that. But all of that, I was creating electronic music when EDM didn't even exist. And all of those are passions which kept on building. And all of this comes together now when I run a design technology company, because I learned from there and I built a foundation. And I did that at various scales in my life as well. Now, this is the kind of things that are actually few things which I've listed down, which I happened to do in those 3 or 4 or 5 years which were packed. I happened to be at the AA, which was, again, I mentioned, one of the best schools in the world for architecture. I worked with a robotics company after that, which was an eye-opener to understand a new technology altogether, that yes, robots can do something interesting in design as well. Worked with Zaha Hadid Architects, which is, again, one of the best companies, and then I got an art residency to move to Los Angeles. Now, this was a very big decision in my life. You know, everybody asked me till date now, why did you choose to leave a job at Zaha's, which is not that easy to get? You got a UK visa and you left that to move forward. Why did you do that? And I still ask that to myself. And I'll tell you a very interesting thing that happened that time. When the residency call happened and I was called to Los Angeles to set up the studio for 6 months, I knew that life was not going to go back. There is no rewind button. I have to take a call here. It actually reminded me of, there's a very famous architect, one of my favorites, Frank Gehry, in his documentary, he talks about an incident where he took risks. And he felt like taking a risk once which changed his life, which felt like jumping off a cliff. And to be honest with you, I felt exactly the same thing. I just thought this is the moment. You know, this is a big risk that I need to take. Somewhere subconsciously, my mind told me that, and my heart told me, in fact, that I need to take this risk. And I moved on. What I did in all of this time is gathered a lot of global experience and exposure. And that brings me to the next part, the next lesson that I've learned is the human mind is more powerful than what we can imagine. This is again a realization that happened at the AA, when I was studying at the AA, and something very interesting happened. It was not a very good thing actually, but I ended up being hospitalized for something, and I don't look sad here. I look quite happy here, but it was a very sad moment at that time, and it's a very important change in my life that happened that time. I was sitting in this hospital, UCL London, and I was asked to go through some diagnosis and biopsies to understand what is going wrong. And next day, I had a lecture. I had to give a presentation. And I thought to myself, I can't miss that. I don't have time to do that. So what do I do? I ended up going against the doctor's advice. Sorry about that. There's a doctor here. Don't do that again. And gave a talk next day. How did I manage to even stand up and give a talk? It was all in the mind. And that's something I realized that time, that you kind of have some superpowers, you know, which kind of come out when life puts you in certain circumstances and situations. And that was the time when I realized that mind can do a lot. Tests happened, turns out that I was having tuberculosis, which the good thing was that was curable. But again, I had to take very strong medications for the next 6 months. And I was asked to, kind of defer my program by my tutors as well. But I thought that, no, I can't do that. There's no time in life. I got to be quick. Because I had built that thing about speed. And all those medicines, I mean, makes you drowsy, makes you lethargic, makes you not being able to work. Somehow I trained the mind, had like 10, 12 capsules every day, just like that as food, and continued and worked. And it worked out for me. Ended up, I graduated from the AA with flying colors. And that's where I realized, you know, that mind really has a lot of powers. You know, you can do a lot by training your mind to do something. And this is what I've been doing now as well. I run three verticals in my company. It's a very small company, but again, what we try to do is expand and try to do as many things as possible. So we are actually delving into art, we're delving into furniture, products, lighting, architecture, interior design, urban design. And the biggest of all right now is design education, where we are trying to teach these technologies to students and young professionals to learn and make a change through bottom-up approach into the industry. And that's what we've been dedicated onto. And this was again after the AA, I went to RoboFold, worked with a couple of robots. And this was Zaha's office, where we were kind of doing some amazing stuff. And this was a life-changing experience that I still have. And through all of that comes down to the last point, which is about something that my parents often keep telling me, almost on a weekly basis over dinner conversations. To be grounded, be humble, and be human. First, become a good human being before anything else. And trust me, I follow that principle pretty much on a daily basis to keep myself calm, to control all of this noise around with so many things that are happening around. And that makes a lot of difference. And all of these five things actually come together to, which can actually change your life, you know, and that's pretty much what I've been doing with my small little company, Rat Lab, and trying to expand that through various verticals. And it's really about finding your passion. And I urge all of you to understand these things and find your passions and follow your passions as a dream. Convert your passions into a dream that doesn't let you sleep. Thank you.